Well, it seems that the Supreme Court is going to have to rule on President Obama's health care plan after the latest ruling in the 11th Circuit striking down part of the law as unconstitutional.
Several other cases against the law are also working their way through the courts. Some judges have ruled in favor of the law and some against. John Jessup has this look at where things go from here.
Of the thousands of petitions the Supreme Court receives each year, only about 100 get to present their cases before the justices in oral arguments. And many legal analysts believe among the cases the high court will consider this term, recent rulings on President Obama's health care reform law.
Here you have more than half the state suing the federal government. I can't remember in recent memory, and when I say recent memory, stretching back well over 100 years looking at cases, seeing any case in which you had that fact pattern.
The latest ruling by the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals addresses a central legal question. Can the government tell Americans what they have to buy? The court said no, striking down the law's requirement for all Americans to have health insurance, basically saying Congress was overstepping its constitutional power by forcing people to buy a certain product, in this case, health insurance. The court called the individual mandate breathtaking and expansive, with no limiting principles to confine congressional power. In the majority opinion, it states that Congress cannot mandate that individuals enter into contracts with private insurance companies for the purchase of an expensive product from the time they are born until the time they die. But the courts are sending mixed signals. Earlier this year, the Sixth Circuit Court ruled in favor of the law. An appeal is pending, which would likely affect other legal challenges concerning this law.
If the Sixth Circuit case gets accepted by the court, the Supreme Court could simply go ahead and pull up all the other cases that are currently pending before the courts of appeals that it wants to hear, and almost certainly it would want to hear this case involving more than half the states.
Because the law gives Congress enormous authority in the lives of everyday Americans, the justices may well be thinking about future cases and other applications beyond just health care. Some analysts believe the high court will strike down only the individual mandate, taking away Congress's ability to force Americans to buy health insurance, and that could spell an uncertain future for the rest of the law.
There's a good chance that the Supreme Court will take a very restrained view. They'll cut out the mandate and very, very likely leave a lot of the other provisions standing. And what that's going to do is create a lot of work for Congress and the president thereafter to figure out what they're going to do with the mess that remains.
John Jessup, CBN News, the Supreme Court.
Thanks, John. Well, Jay Sekulow of the American Center for Law and Justice is here. And Jay, the American Center represents a couple hundred congressmen.
Yeah, about 84 congressmen in this one, another group of 80 in another one. So collectively, yeah, a lot of congressmen. You know, Pat, it's an interesting situation because you've got the 11th Circuit declaring the mandate unconstitutional. The Sixth Circuit went the other way. So what happens now? The Supreme Court's got to take it. This is not a case the Supreme Court can avoid. We've got a major argument, September 23rd, D.C. Court of Appeals. So you're going to have the Fourth Circuit we're waiting for. You got the 11th Circuit, the Sixth Circuit, and the D.C. Circuit. This case is going to the Supreme Court of the United States.
Well, you got the Fourth Circuit here in Virginia, too.
Yeah, we're waiting for that literally any day now. And, you know, these are close cases. It's coming down to two things. And I heard what you said on the program yesterday. It's the individual mandate, but now this issue of severability is becoming front and center. It wasn't going to be. And now it is.
Well, the old rule was that if one part of a law was unconstitutional, the whole thing fell.
Right.
Because the court wasn't going to say, well, this is good and this is bad.
Yeah.
But the 11th Circuit did just that.
Went the other way. And interestingly, normally there's a severability provision in the act. So it'll say, if this is held unconstitutional, the rest of it applies. That wasn't in this. The court read an implied right of severability under the concept that when you've got a congressional act, you try to save it. Here's the problem with that reasoning. Yeah. I think they were wrong on that point. This, you take the individual mandate out of Obamacare, it cannot function. I don't think economically it functions anyways. It cannot function. So this idea that somehow you can, you know, piecemeal and carve out the ones you want and the ones you don't want, it just doesn't work.
Well, do you think the Supreme Court, when it finally, well, you don't know how the Supreme Court's going to come out on it.
It's going to be, you know, here's my concern. We just had in the Sixth Circuit a very conservative judge, a guy we really like, was a clerk of Justice Scalia. And he ruled that the mandate was barely constitutional. He said it's on the outer edges of the Commerce Clause, but he gave it authority. What's interesting about this, though, the 11th Circuit, there was great language. It said the economic mandate represents a wholly novel and potentially unbounded assertion of congressional authority. That needs to be the theme of this case going to the Supreme Court of the United States. This is unbounded congressional authority. If they can do this, Literally, Congress can do anything.
You remember under the New Deal legislation, they actually forced farmers to kill little pigs. I mean, that was, you know, in order, because they said, well, there's too much agriculture and we want to get the prices up. And the court struck it down, then they turned around and reversed themselves.
Correct. And what you've got here, the risk with this case is walking to the Supreme Court of the United States 6 months from now or a year from now and assuming you've got conservative justices going one way and liberal justices going another. I think that's a big mistake here. We have to fight for every single vote in this case. But this bill has to go for two reasons. Number one, it is a huge power grab by the federal government. Number two, it is the largest federal funding of abortion in our lifetime. When you look at the legislation and what's really allowed in this, this is an abortion bill. This should be called the Planned Parenthood Protection Act.
Well, that's, of course, what the liberals have been doing. Right. They're imposing themselves. But it's amazing that Obama spent all that time. I mean, when he should have been worrying about the economy, right. He spent all that time on health care.
And look at the disaster for the economy is an economic disaster. But, Pat, you picked on something yesterday that not a lot of people are talking about, and that is the severability issue. What we need to be communicating out there is we now don't have just one issue before the Supreme Court of the United States on the individual mandate that I must buy the insurance, which is, to me, a much easier case. We now have, because of the 11th Circuit, a second issue, and that is if the mandate goes, what happens to this bill, this law, and does the law as applied without the mandate bury us even worse than Obamacare buried us, which is as bad as it could be, but this could be worse.
How many clients is the ACLJ? You carry all those congressmen?
You've got all the congressmen. So we've got seven plaintiffs, including medical professionals, in the main case in D.C. So, and I think it was 180,000 of our members signed on to a brief that we filed. So it's been a huge case. And my concern here is the battle is now just beginning. What happens in these district courts and the Court of Appeals, it's fun, but it's not the reality where it goes.
From the Heritage Foundation, said, never have we had seen this many states attorneys general and all the
27.
It's unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
Never
by the way, our good friend Paul Clement did the argument in the 11th Circuit, did a magnificent job. So we've got a good legal team. You've got Paul Clement handling the 4th Circuit case. Our team's handling the D.C. Circuit case. Good lawyers handling it in the 4th Circuit. We're going to see what happens. 6th Circuit as well. Good teams there. But it's going to be, it's all going to the Supreme Court. And they'll probably, the Heritage guy was right. I think they're going to consolidate all.
That law's got to go.
Jake Sekulow,
well, I appreciate what you're doing. Ladies and gentlemen, the American Center for Law and Justice fighting for you. Support Jay and his folks. Pray for them. And we'll talk about some more cases they have. Thank you so much.
God bless you. Thanks.
Jay Sekulow, a fighter for you and me. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN Newsroom. Lee?
Pat, President Obama unveils a jobs program for rural America. The announcement is part of his three-day bus tour through the Midwest. The plan includes more money for rural businesses through a small business investment program, conferences for businesses and investors, and help in finding doctors for small rural hospitals. The administration does not have an estimate, though, for how many new jobs the plan will create. The White House says it will not cost taxpayers any additional money. Pat, I don't know how they can make that claim.
Well, everything they do is going to cost money. There's nothing that the Obama administration is going to do that isn't going to cost you and me money. But the thing is, if they would just take some of those regulations off, if they just bring in some certainty about taxes, but they have left the business community in a welter of uncertainty. And then he goes in the Midwest and we're going to have some farm co-ops, or we're going to all talk to people about how to make things better, and we're going to get the agriculture department involved. That's not going to do it. He is going after business big time. And for some reason, on the one hand, he talks one thing and he does with the other. And what he does with the other is hurting business and killing jobs. Not a good situation. Lee.
Al-Qaeda's new leader is calling on his followers to continue to fight the U.S. despite the death of Osama bin Laden. In a video posted on militant websites around the world, Ayman al-Zawahiri calls America a, quote, criminal country that has corrupted the world. He also says the uprisings in Egypt and Tunisia have provided opportunities for the group to spread its message. CBN News terrorism analyst Eric Stackelback told me Zawahiri is trying to keep the flames of jihad burning.
What I do think it shows, Lee, is that, look, Al-Qaeda is trying to give the impression to the world that after the death of Osama bin Laden, they're not skipping a beat. It's going to be business as usual for their organization. What Zawahiri's trying to do here is project an image of strength and project an image that, hey, bin Laden might be gone, but the fight carries on, the jihad carries on.
To hear the full interview with Eric, you can go to our webpage at cbnnews.com. Pat, Eric also told me that Al-Qaeda certainly does not have as much bark, as much bite to its bark as it used to, but it's still a significant organization.
Well, it's not so much Al-Qaeda any longer. I think Al-Qaeda was spawned, if I understand it, by the Muslim Brotherhood. They have spawned many things like Hamas and like Hezbollah in Lebanon. These are outshoots of the Muslim Brotherhood, which is now presenting itself as very reasonable, very peace-loving, which is a front. They want to establish a caliphate. They want to bring in Sharia law. They want to control as much territory as they can. And every time there's an uprising and some pro-Western dictator, as evil as he is, gets overthrown, who comes in to fill the vacuum? The Muslim Brotherhood. So keep your eyes open and just be cautious. But, you know, I know the Assad family was brutal and repressive in Syria, but the one thing about those Alawites is they did protect the Christians. If the militant Muslims get in charge in Syria, they will persecute. Same thing is happening to the Coptic Church in Egypt. They're being persecuted. Lee?
Pat, more consumers are paying off their credit cards on time. Late payments are at their lowest level in 17 years. According to the credit reporting agency TransUnion, the national credit card delinquency rate has fallen to 0.60%. That's compared to 0.92% a year ago. The improved payment habits come despite an increase in the use of credit cards. Experts say there are a variety of factors behind it: tighter restrictions on credit card applicants and consumers simply taking out less debt. Just 15 minutes of exercise each day, may be all you need to live longer. For years, we've heard that 30 minutes was the magic number, but new evidence suggests that being physically active for half that time still reaps significant health benefits. Researchers found that those who exercise just 15 minutes a day extend their life expectancy by 3 years compared to those with no exercise. Doctors hope the new findings encourage people to incorporate more physical activity into their lives. Pat?
I am not going to settle for 3 years. I'm going for 19.
Well, I would hope so.
I hope riding the horse counts as exercise.
Absolutely.
It does.
Don't you think?
Well, I would hope.
Yes. I think especially the way that you ride.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very
stressful.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, anyhow, I get up now. I'm out at 7 in the morning in my big horse. It's fun. It's just cool. It was 9 degrees here.
No, that is the secret to doing exercise regularly, to find something that's fun for you that you can do,
well,
that you enjoy and will go back to day after day.
If horse counts as exercise, it's fun. All right.
Welcome to Washington for this CBN News break. The leaders of Germany and France are working together to address Europe's debt crisis. German Chancellor Angela Merkel and French President Nicolas Sarkozy are taking the lead in pushing for economic reforms. The two countries account for almost half of Europe's economic output. These meetings come after a week of trouble for the European and world financial markets. A judge in Indiana declines a request to block the state's new school voucher program. Teachers and some religious leaders were seeking an injunction against the vouchers, claiming they violate the state constitution by providing public money to religious institutions. The judge denied the request, saying the program is, quote, religion neutral, and taxpayer money will only be paid to religious schools when a parent chooses to do so. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.